You realize who it is?
Yes.
Hi,
my
Ron.
My son has me in.
Huh?
My son has just got me out of bed.
Your son, Ron, is a heck of a kid. Your son, Derek, is a heck of a kid.
I know.
He knows it, right? You know,
I know he's a heck of a kid.
He really is. What a night. I enjoy talking to him. And what a story about being saved by him saving the dog, Ginger, and then Ginger saving him. What a story.
Well, yeah, it was quite a thing for a while there until the other people realized that there was a commercial value in the dog.
That was, what do you mean?
Well, commemoration. Derek was one of 20 chosen throughout the United States Hero of the Year Award.
Oh, yeah.
And then shortly afterwards, we didn't see hide and hair of the animal. We notified the other people that Derek and
Ginger
were they were being selected for the
award.
Hero of the Year.
Right.
Award. And all of a sudden, the only time we see the animal anymore is when he happens to get loose. They keep him pretty well chained up, and et cetera, et cetera.
Oh, I get the story behind the story.
Yes, I think it's, I can't say anything about
it. Yeah, I understand. And hey, what about...
that's just the way it is. I think these people... I can say a lot about them.
No, Ronald Jones is the FBI speaking. Be careful what you say.
Never mind what the FBI have to say.
Yeah, listen, one thing I'd like to get back to bed. What about this ice fishing? Where do you go ice fishing? You know, what's it like?
Oh.
I go down to Landon. I go in the South Boston. I go down to A Street and et cetera, any place where I can get smelts.
Dad, tell them about freshwater fishing, what you do.
Never mind about my freshwater
fishing. He catches 40,000-pound basses. I swear to God.
He swears. What does he catch?
No, I know it gets 45.
He enters contests sometimes, and
yes,
he wins them, too, with big fish. Because one time he was down this place, and there was a certain fish nobody could catch.
Yes.
Right? So
right.
One day he said, I'm going to catch this fish. He put his rod down on the ground and put a rock on it, right?
Right.
And he left. He returned about 6 hours later. When he came back, the rod was halfway bent down the stream, and he caught the fish.
Son of a gun. How much did it weigh?
It wasn't the way it went.
Oh.
Well, tell me the way it went. That's what you said. You put the rock on the fishing rod.
Yeah, didn't you tell Derek the story right, Dad?
I told Derek the story right, but you know it gets exaggerated. I was sitting in the barroom called Hosey's, and I picked up my rod and reel with my eldest son, Ronald Jones.
66240.
And I said, I'm going to go out and catch the biggest fish in the pond. And I went out and I caught the biggest fish in the pond.
How much? How much? Hey, that's pretty good.
A largemouth bass.
Well, Derek is really proud of you. No matter what you do, Derek is proud of you.
Never mind. I'm really proud of my son. For what he did and what the dog did for him.
Right.
Derek is a...
What was that?
Derek is one in a million.
Yeah.
Hey, Dad, you can say I'm 15, but I act like 6, right?
Oh, what a nice
That's
kid.
Very true.
Yeah. Hey, well, listen. Hey, Derek, did we issue you a Glick University T-shirt?
Yeah, but
what?
I think it's in my drawer. I was wearing it last week, but I think I think I've grown out of it.
Really?
Yeah. Why? Well, are you going to send me a whole year subscription?
Hello?
Glick University T-shirts?
Hello, operator. Hello, operator. I can't hear this kid. Hello,
yes,
operator.
Yes, operator.
Operator, I can't hear.
Yes, operator?
Yeah.
No.
Well, listen.
Never mind that.
I'll stick my ball constrictor on you,
Mr.
Glick.
Well, hold it, Mr. Jones. We'll pay off it.
Okay.
You
can sell things.
Hold on a second.
Don't worry about his ball constrictor. It's not that big yet.
All right. Derek, you hold on. Ronald, thank you very much. Stu, would you take care of that little Derek? Because we don't want him to wear one that's unsightly. Okay, thanks very much.
No, I don't want him to wear anything unsightly either.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, Larry, have a good, happy new year, and I'll call you maybe in the next 2 or 3 months, all right?
Okay, Derek.
Okay.
So long, Ronald.
Okay.
Bye, Mr. Rick.
So long, fellas.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
This is WBZ's Norm Nathan. Be sure to join me tonight at 1 o'clock after Larry Glick as I sit in for Lou Marcel. We'll have a good time keeping each other company, and you can be part of the fun by calling 254-5678. The Lou Marcel Show with me, Norm Nathan, tonight at 1, right after Larry Glick, and just ahead of Maynard in the Morning on AM Stereo, WBZ Radio 1030. WBZ
Boston. That Norm will do something to the cockles of your heart. I don't know what he does, but it's fun, though. You'll like him. Norm Nathan will be here in about a half hour. The Massachusetts Daily Lottery number drawn at the WBZ studio, 6727, 6727. And the WBZ IQ of the forecast from meteorologist Mike Bodner. Overnight, increasing cloudiness, lows 28 to 32 Friday. It'll be cloudy with snow arriving around midday, continuing into Friday night. The snow may mix with rain, especially along the coast. Potential of 1 to 3 inches accumulation in the city with higher amounts in the suburbs. The high temperature 35. Low Friday night, 24. Saturday will be brisk and cold with sunshine returning. High close to 30 in Boston now. It's 36 wicked mint awesome degrees. Hi, sports fans on the BZ scoreboard. Ace Glick reporting. In the NBA... Boston 122, Indiana 104, Washington 115, and New York 109. In the NHL, Islanders 7 and Boston 5, Buffalo 2, Detroit 2, Quebec 3, and Hartford 2. Basketball, Glick University 169, Nathan University School of Animal Husbandry 3. One for each chicken. That's it, sports fans. On with the show. Sports and music courtesy of Craig Nasha. Hit him up, round him up. Get him on the train. 254-5678. Hello.
Hello, Larry.
Hello, this is Larry.
Yes, it's Ben calling from Norwich, Ontario, Canada.
Hey, how's our Canadian cousin up there?
Not too bad.
That's good.
I think I have an interesting call for you tonight. Oh, pardon me. First, I got to tell you, I'm a first-time caller.
Hold it, Ben. A round of applause to make you feel welcome here.
Thank you. You and I have something in common.
What is it, Ben?
I was born on your birthday.
Another May 16th.
Right on.
Right. You feel good about it, Ben?
Oh, great, great, excellent. Second-generation listener.
Oh, very good. What do you do for a living?
I run a sound equipment store.
Oh, yeah.
Keyboards and that kind of thing.
Keyboards?
Keyboards.
Well, I get home tonight, I'm going to practice for about a half hour.
Yeah, well, that's good. You have to do that.
You have to, that's the whole thing. I have to get some motivation to... A thought, because I want to play, and sometimes I don't practice, and I get a guilt feeling. I have to get back and do it, right?
That's right.
Are you a good keyboard man?
Sure I am.
How often do you practice, or how long?
Well, if Dad's listening, he'll tell me almost all day.
See, that's different, right. You'll really love to practice, right?
Oh, yeah, I'd love to. I have a band of my own.
What's the name of it?
Toasted Western.
Oh, it's country western?
Yeah.
I'm back in the saddle again.
That's right.
That's where a friend is a friend. Howdy, friends and neighbors. It's old Ben, old cousin Ben up in Ontario, sitting around a campfire roasting marshmallows.
Right on.
Right on. What do you... how many instruments do you play?
Well, primarily I play bass.
Bass?
Mm-hmm.
But you're a keyboard man, too.
I'm starting into that now, yeah.
Oh, you're just starting?
I've dabbled with it for a long time. Now I'm just starting to get into it.
You're taking lessons or doing it yourself?
Doing it myself.
Well, don't you think it would be better? I mean, you're a musician and take lessons from a qualified teacher?
My aunt's a teacher.
Your aunt?
Yes. Practically everybody in my father's family plays an instrument of some sort.
All right. Do you want to do a little number for us, Cousin Ben?
I haven't got anything here in the kitchen.
Oh. All right.
What I'm calling about is I think I have an interesting call.
Hey?
I think I have an interesting call.
Okay.
It's to my wife's uncle, who's in England right now on a teacher exchange. This is his second teacher exchange. The first time a few years ago. They went to the Yukon on a teacher exchange, and now they're in England, and they just got back from Austria on a holiday.
Yes?
And I thought it would be interesting to call them and see what, how life is different over there for them compared to Toronto, Canada.
Hey? Hey?
Yeah, I'm wondering if life's any different over for them there. Yeah,
I just like to say, hey.
I know you do.
Hey? Life, yeah, I wish it, too bad you don't have any, your instruments. I'd like to hear a Canadian sing a little country western.
Oh, well, you can't win them all.
No, you can't. That'd be a good call, Ben.
All right.
What's the name of your store? No, what's the name of your store?
White Sound.
White Sound?
Mm-hmm.
Very good. All right. Do you sell a Casio up there?
I sure do.
What's the most expensive Casio do you have? One of the five octaves.
The most expensive one I have in right now would be $995.
$995.
And that's Canadian.
That's what I got. I got that one. Five octave.
Yeah, it's a good board.
It does everything, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
They're a lot of fun.
Well, let me ask you a question. I also got, you know the Gorilla amplifier?
Right on. I have that too.
You have the Gorilla amplifier?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I just got this, the amplifier, and you know the on and off on the right side of the amplifier?
Right.
That thing just, it's not working.
It's not working.
No, it's like, it just doesn't switch on and off. Is that a problem? Is that
on
a serious?
On the right-hand side, yeah. Yeah. There's that tube stack on the left-hand side. Eh?
That one, the left side works, the right one doesn't. What do I do?
I'd take it back. How long have you had it?
A couple of months.
I'd take it back and have them look at it, because it's not a serious job to have a switch replaced if it's gone bad anyway.
Okay. I have to speak to Al Mancini.
Al Mancini, has he got a sound store?
Yep.
Yeah?
Al Mancini up in Lynn.
Oh, yeah.
You know where it is?
I have an idea.
All right, he's the distributor, I think, for this area.
Oh, yeah.
Well, okay. I'll have to record. As soon as I get to get it down and know what I'm doing with it, I'll record something and I'll put it on the air.
All right.
All right, Cousin Ben, stay on the line and give it to Cousin Stuart.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
254-5678. Hello.
Hi, Larry.
Hi there.
How you doing?
Let me check. Pretty good, thank you.
That's good. Pardon me?
What's your first name?
Steve.
From where?
I told Stu Dorchester, but I'm from Holbrook.
Oh, why did...
Well, I slipped. I'm a Dorchester boy.
Oh, okay. Oh, but you're Holbrook, eh?
Yeah, in Holbrook now.
Yeah.
But I want to tell you funny... it's kind of ironic what happened to me. I went out to Vegas.
Right.
And we get into our room, stayed at the MGM Grand.
All right, across from Batista's.
Well, wait a second. Oh. Don't jump the story, Larry.
Oh, sorry.
So a bunch of guys I'm out there with, well, we got to get a bite to eat. I said, okay, so where do you want to go? They said, I don't know. I said, well, I'm going to take a shower, and we'll talk about it. So I get out of the shower, I pull my curtains open, and I see Batista's hole in the wall. But wait. Yeah. Before I tell you this.
Go ahead. I can laugh if I want
to. All right. The day before I leave, my mother-in-law, who's a Glicknick, calls me. She said, if you go to Las Vegas, you've got to go to Batista's.
Right.
I said, what's Batista's? She said, Larry Glick always talks about it. This guy's great. He sings on the phone, da-da-da-da-da.
Right.
So now I open the curtains, and we're right across the street.
Right.
So I call up the guys I'm with. I said, we'll go to Batista's. He says, this one guy says, oh, Batista's. What's that? He says, it's an Italian restaurant. It's very nice. So we go out to Batista's. So we get our booth. We slide into the booth. And we're sitting there waiting for the waiter. I look up. Whose picture's sitting over my head? Lorenzo Gliciano.
Right.
I couldn't believe it, right?
Couldn't believe it.
So now the guy sitting next to me, I said, you know who that is? He says, yeah, that's Larry Glick. My mother told me to come to this restaurant.
Yeah.
I said, you're kidding me. My mother-in-law told me to come here.
Right.
So now we're sitting in a restaurant. This little old Italian guy comes by with the accordion.
Oh, yeah.
And I said, we know Larry Glick very well, which was kind of lying a little bit because I don't know you that well.
Right.
He says, Larry was here 6 weeks ago.
Right.
And then he asked me for a dollar to play a song.
He didn't ask you.
No, he didn't. He didn't ask for a buck, but we gave him a buck. He sang it's a nice song.
He wouldn't ask you for a buck.
But he had like $3 bills sticking out of the accordion. What are you going to do?
He had Nunzio.
But he said he knew you.
Yeah, I know Nunzio.
So it was okay. So now we're sitting, and I see this guy walking around. He looks like he owns the place.
Right.
So I say, you wouldn't be Batista. He says, I am.
Yeah.
I said, I want to tell you. I said, the only reason I'm here
is
because my mother-in-law listens to Larry Glick, and the guy sitting next to me, and my mother listens to Larry Glick. So he went there, he says, that's wonderful. He came back, he gave us nice record albums.
Right.
He said, if you know Larry, you're a friend of mine.
Isn't that nice?
That was nice.
Hey, do you know why I like him so much? He came here from Italy, you know, broke. He didn't have two cents. And he never went to school because he lived, he's in his 50s, you know, and there was no schooling. He was in Italy during the war.
Yeah.
And he grew up, and he was a kid, and there was no schooling. He came here, and he was broke. He told me he took all kinds of jobs, menial tasks, jobs that no one else would take, you know. And then he and his wife, he married an American girl, and they went out to Las Vegas. And he worked for this guy in his little restaurant. It was just one little store, not the way it is now. It was just one little store. It was called a hole in the wall because it was a little hole. And he was broke. He had four or five kids and broke. And he kept working. Like, he works 12, 14, 15 hours a day. And today he's a multimillionaire. See? That's a nice. Hey. That's the Batista. That's a nice. That's good. Hold on. Hold on, Steve. Fischerello, piripipipipipa, e compare, si fa suonare, a che se suona, è la trombetta, e come se suona, è la trombetta, a tutto tutto saxofona, pappa pappa, la trombetta, fischerello, piripipipipipa, e compare, si fa suonare, a che se suona, o Larry Glick, a come se suona, è Larry Glick, a tutto tutto saxofona, pappa pappa, la trombetta. Piscarello, piripipipipi. Hey! Little nunzio on the accordion.
Very nice.
So, hey, Steve.
Yeah.
So, you know, he came and he worked, and like 25 years ago, someone said, hey, Nunzio, if you can get, I mean, Nunzio is the guitarist, the accordionist. They said, Batista, if you can get some money. He owns property where the hotels are built on. He borrowed money from banks when he was just getting started. And today he's a multimillionaire. He owns a whole shopping center. He started only in America, man. He came broke. He started off. He bought three stores next to his little hole in the wall restaurant.
Oh yeah, right. Little shopping center there.
Yeah, and then he bought that shopping center, and he owns all his property down there.
Oh, nice restaurant. We had a good meal there.
And he started to fly too.
Is that right?
Now let me tell you something. The thing that really has my admiration. He gets your instrument rating in aviation. Yeah, to me, it was difficult for me. It was really difficult. Now, he never went to school. And especially, and he never studied English. And the technical part of it. But what he did, he had the stick-to-itiveness, the tenacity. He hired a pilot, an American Air Force pilot, who flew in Vietnam.
Mm-hmm.
And he had the desire, said, I want to learn to fly. And every day they'd go into a motel for 4 hours, and he'd cram every day. He said, hey, what's this? He said, that's a machine. What's this? This is a stick. It's a magneto. What does it do? And over until he has all the ratings now. Would you believe that?
That's great.
Yeah, I mean, you have to give a person like that respect. I mean, he's up every day at 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning. He works out. He's in his mid-50s, works out in the gym. And he's there.
He's in great shape.
Yeah, he's there at 6 o'clock in the morning. And we've just become good friends over the years.
You're going to give him a new pitcher, though. That pitcher does you no justice. you must have been at that other station when you gave him that pitcher.
That's right.
You know?
All right, listen, I'm glad you went over and had a good time. Did you make any money? What did you gamble at? The MGM?
MGM, yeah.
How much
a good casino to gamble at.
How much money did you make?
Didn't make any money.
How much did you lose?
Well, a few dollars.
Yeah.
But, you know, the funny thing was I had a chuckle. I'm not an over religious person,
yes.
But I went to mass while I was out there. I went to church.
Right.
So I went to the Cathedral for the Guardian Angel. It's right on the strip. So I went to 9 o'clock mass on Sunday morning. And standing room only. So the priest comes out this is before the mass starts, and the priest comes out, he said, I want you to know that we only have 126 parishioners in our parish.
Huh.
So he said, you can look around the church and tell that 99% of you are tourists, and we welcome you to our church. And he said, we're not a proud parish. He said, we take personal checks, and we take chips.
And
they had two collections. You should have seen all the poker chips on the collection box.
I'll be a such.
I get the biggest kick out of that.
They have poker chips.
Yeah, he said, the priest mentioned, he said, we're the only people that go into a casino and come out with the same amount of money we went in with.
Yeah.
So they go into the casinos and they cash in the chips.
That's
funny. It's a very nice church.
That's very nice. That's interesting.
I thought it was pretty good.
Money is money. It's paper and chips, right?
That's right.
Oh, listen, these two friends you just reminded me out in Las Vegas, they were arguing as to who made the best wine, the best homemade Italian wine. So Nunzio said that he made wine and that all his friends came over and they really enjoyed it. They said it was the best homemade wine they have ever had.
Yeah.
So Rico said, my wine is the best, he said. It's the strongest and the best, he says. As a matter of fact, one night I had my next door neighbors over and they drank and they drank and drank. And the next morning they get up and they went to mass. He said, oh, what's so unusual about that? He says, oh, they're Jewish. Okay. Take care of yourself.
All right, Larry, be good.
So long.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
The long wait is over. The date, January 24th.
The place, Crotchet Mountain in Francistown, New Hampshire.
And the event?
BZ's famous Schuss Boomer Blast, and you can be part of the fun.
Starting Monday, just be the correct caller and win 6 ski packages that include free lift tickets,
ski lessons,
equipment rental,
a barbecued chicken dinner,
musical entertainment,
and a lot of free family fun.
WBZ's 7th Annual Schuss Boomer Blast, January 24th.
Your chance to win starts Monday from AM Stereo.
WBZ, Radio 1030.
WBZ Boston.
254-5678.
Hello?
Hello?
Larry?
Yes.
This is Patrick from Wakefield.
Hi, Patrick.
How you doing?
Let me check. Not bad, thank you.
I'm a first-time caller.
You know what you get, Patrick?
Yes.
What?
Round of applause.
That's right.
Larry.
Patrick.
I have two calls for you.
Name it.
One, I went to Hawaii, and I got some calls for you there.
Yes, and did you pick up any Hawaiian women?
No.
How old are you?
14.
Oh, did you like Hawaii?
Yes, it was nice.
Good swimming, good food.
Oh, yeah, the waves were great.
Weather was great?
Uh-huh, 80 degrees.
Oh, son of a gun. Go ahead.
One's at a nightclub.
Yes?
In Waikiki Beach.
What's the name of it?
Scruples.
Were you there?
No, I just got it, and I thought that would be interesting.
Right.
And I have another one that's the lounge with the restaurant. It's Kihi Seas in Maui.
Well, we have the number at Scruples. Would you believe that? Stu just told me we have the number there.
Oh.
That's okay. It shows you're working on. That's we're appreciative of that.
Well, the one at TEC's is good.
Huh?
It's a lounge, and it's the only piano and organ in that town that has a nightclub.
Oh, in Maui?
Yeah. There's this town called Kiai. Kiai.
Is that near Lui, Mui, Nui, and Sui?
Yeah.
Oh.
And they have an organ and bar and entertainment.
Oh, that's very nice, Patrick. You're a nice kid.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, stay on, give it to Stu, okay? Stu, that would be a nice number. Night and you in blue Hawaii. Look at, hey, Patrick, you're gone now, but here's Norm Nathan just came in doing the little Hawaiian dance. He looked kind of silly, but anyways, he has rhythm. And these guys from up north, for chicken flickers, really have rhythm. Oh, I know.
Hello. Hi, Larry.
I know.
I was doing my... I was a native folk dance I was doing.
Oh, I didn't know that.
No, that's why what I do is I grease my body, as you have noticed, and I slip into my loincloth.
You look like Mr. America.
Yeah, I know it. I know it. I'm really built. Boy, I'm, you know, I go by a group of women construction workers,
yeah,
and they whistle at me.
You don't mind me, Mr.
What a hunk they cry out, you know. I'm sorry. Excuse me?
No. I'm sorry.
No,
you don't mind when I say that Nathan University School of Chicken Flicking, you don't mind?
No, I don't mind that, except
you
always,
we
always only score 1 or 2 points.
That's all you'll ever get, because you only one for each chicken, three of them. That's as high as you can get.
And I just don't understand why Glick University beats everybody,
including
my chicken flickers all the time.
We have ringers. Our players are 7'3".
I see. they're not all students at your school. Is that what you're telling me?
No, they're most of them are ex-cons.
I see, and
but
you pay them
though.
Plenty to come in.
We pay them off in chicken feathers.
And you still call them amateurs.
Yes.
You're kind of skirting the law. You're kind of living right at the edge, aren't you?
Wish you wouldn't. Let's not go too depth.
Sorry.
Stu just said, let's try to take one more call. I think we have one more. Hold, you can stay right there, please.
Okay.
Hello?
Hi, Larry.
Hi there. What's your first name?
Linda.
Hi, Linda.
I'm from Medway.
Oh, listen, Medway. This is a musical program. We only have a minute. Linda.
I just called to help out that poor woman that needed to know the name of the dog on Petticoat Junction.
You know the name of that dog?
Yeah. She sounded kind of desperate, so I thought I'd help her out.
Yes, yes. And this is probably the last call. What's the name of that dog?
Dog.
They called it Dog?
Yeah. Just Dog, yeah.
That was the name of the dog.
See, I don't know, on your contract here, but in our contract, they ask us to view as little TV as possible, so I don't watch TV at all because I want to be sure I have the job.
No, yeah. My contract is similar. It says don't watch TV, but talk with people who do.
Yes. Right.
Dog. Yeah, I'm glad you said that, really.
The name of the dog was Dog, and you promised her she'd know the answer by the end of the night, so there it is.
Linda, you saved me.
She sounded like she had money on her or something, you know?
I agree. Now, your name is Linda, and Norm Nathan, he knows... He has a great musical background. Give me the melody to Linda, the song Linda.
When I go to sleep, I never count sheep. Yeah. I count all the charms about Linda.
A little more feeling, though. You're doing like you're reciting it like at the third grade. A little feeling.
Oh, there's another one, though.
What?
Linda.
Well, I think I like that one better. How's that go? Linda?
Yeah.
Let me give the chorus.
Oh, no, it's the same song. I'm sorry.
Wait a minute, Linda. I just want Norm. Once again, a little slower, as if you're Buddy Clark.
Buddy Clark?
Yeah.
When I go to sleep, I never count sheep, oh no.
Oh, right.
I count all the charms up. Am I overdoing it just a little bit?
I'm sorry you said that.
I'm sorry.
Just a little.
All right, I'm sorry, okay? I'm so sorry.
Get him up, round him up. Get him on the train. That's it.
Okay.
Linda, thank you, dog.
You're welcome.
So long, Norm.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Good night. Name for a dog. Dog.
It was just a flesh wound.
It's time to say. Biggest flicking a chicken. You can do it fast.
It's gonna hurt. It's gonna hurt when I do it.
Feathers all over the place. Good night. Got the bone piece of each.
We've had a few. And it's time for Toodaloo.
Scooby doo be doo be doo.
Sorry for what we the same.
Good dee ka doo.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
I'll do that.
Good night, folks. And good night, Mrs. Calabash. Wherever.
Good night, folks. Thanks for listening. Thanks for participating. We need you. Each and every one. So long, gang. So long. Au revoir. Hasta luego. Ayer. A Peter Zane. Arrivederci. David Sane. Viso Lantas. Adios. Sayonara. And so on. Norm Nathan here. King of the Chicken Flickers coming up next. And he'll take your call. He'll entertain you. He'll make you chuckle. He'll sing songs for you. He knows Dog. He knows other things, too. He knows Linda.
Carol. Hit him up. Round him up. Get him on the train.
Daryl Gould with the latest news on the station. WBZ Boston, the Spirit of New England Group W, Westinghouse Broadcasting Station. It's 1 o'clock.
Good morning. It's 37 degrees in Boston. WBZ AccuWeather meteorologist Mike Bodner says increasing cloudiness overnight, then snow will arrive around midday Friday. Possibility of 1 to 3 inches accumulation in Boston, higher amounts in the suburbs. I'm Daryl Gould, WBZ News. The management of the Prudential Building in Boston says it hopes the building will be open for business as usual when offices normally start their business day in the morning. There are two hotlines that folks who work at the Pru can call after 5 a.m. to get the latest word. They're 236-3302 or 236-3114. A 9-alarm blaze that broke out on the 14th floor Thursday evening forced evacuation of hundreds of people from the Pru. No one was seriously injured, but 24 people required treatment, mostly for smoke inhalation. Fire Commissioner Leo Stapleton told WBZ's Anthony Silva he's satisfied with the way the evacuation went.
Yeah, I'm very much satisfied. No one died. And we had literally hundreds of buildings, people on 36 floors above the fire. But you can't put a fireman on every floor in every minute immediately. It's a very difficult job. I'm very much satisfied with the performance that happened.
The blaze generated a lot of thick smoke and caused heavy damage to the vacant 14th floor. That floor was undergoing renovation work, which was to include the installation of a sprinkler system. Boston school bus drivers are set for their second day of picketing this morning. On the first day of the strike, Boston school officials say absenteeism was about 25% above normal. The Registry of Motor Vehicles says traffic deaths rose in Massachusetts.